There's a paradox in the way that people talk about battery minerals. On the one hand, we're convinced there's not going to be enough critical minerals, so there will be shortages and prices will rise sky high. And on the other hand, we also think we won't be bothered to recycle. People always say that we are a throw it in the rubbish kind of society, but that is such rubbish. I've never seen someone just drive their old car into landfill and walk away, have you? When people think of batteries getting thrown away willy-nilly, they're thinking of small stuff like phones and Walkmans. So that's certainly wasteful and we shouldn't do that either, but even if we throw all of that away, the amount of battery waste from small products like that is so small compared to the total amount of car and stationary energy batteries that we're going to have to deal with from, say, 2030 onwards. I personally don't think we need to be so pessimistic about this. In this video, I'm going to run through the technologies that we have available to recycle batteries and the main obstacles to scaling this industry up even faster. I'm Rosie Barnes, an engineer with 20 years experience developing clean energy technologies. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Everyone loves the idea of recycling, but what are we actually trying to achieve? Why is recycling important? For metals like steel, aluminium, and copper, recycling practices are well established. Compared to mining, recycling these metals uses less energy, reduces CO2 emissions, and probably most importantly, saves money. Take copper as an example. Producing secondary copper by recycling uses just 1/6 of the energy it takes to produce primary copper, and recycling rates are consequently high. It's estimated that 80% of the copper that has ever been mined is still in use today. For aluminium, recycling takes 1/20th the energy of primary aluminium production, and 75% of the aluminium that's ever been mined is still in use today. Contrast that with things that aren't economic to recycle, like the composite materials used in wind turbine blades, where today's commercially available recycling methods consume more energy and emit more CO2 than if we made new blades from virgin materials. Plus, recycling them using today's methods degrades the materials so much that they can't be used to make new wind turbine blades. They can only be used for low-value non-structural applications like filler material. Recycled copper and aluminium, on the other hand, have the same properties as virgin metals. So in terms of recyclability, we have at one end of the scale metals like copper and aluminium, where recycling is a more energy efficient, lower emissions, cheaper, and equivalent quality alternative to mining. And at the other end of the scale, things like wind turbine blades, where it's more energy intensive, higher emissions, more expensive to recycle blades, and into lower quality, lower value materials. Lithium-ion batteries contain metals such as lithium, nickel, and cobalt, so we might suspect that they belong on the everything is great end of the recycling spectrum. But recycling them isn't nearly as simple as melting down some drinks cans, because the valuable metals in batteries are not pure. They're found within complex chemical compounds. Because of this, recycling batteries needs to use chemical separation processes that are more similar to how the mining industry separates metals from ores. We can recycle batteries, we've always been able to, but that's not really the point. In order to get high recycling rates, the quality and the value of the recycled materials needs to be sufficient to make up for the cost of recycling. To understand how close we are to achieving that, we're going to need to get into some chemical engineering. Now, I don't know about you, but I haven't formally studied chemistry since high school. So while I was researching for this video, I had to learn a lot of new concepts. And honestly, my mind tends to wander when I'm trying to absorb so much new information, and I always have 100 other things on my to-do list. I have recently been introduced to a new product, Magic Mind, which has made a noticeable difference in how focused I am. I started with a 7-day challenge, and I have to say, it's been a game changer. On the first day, I made the mistake of taking it with my second coffee of the day, and I felt a little bit too turbocharged. It was intense. Since then, I've swapped my second coffee with Magic Mind, and I find myself with focused energy that lasts longer. Magic Mind contains performance ingredients like matcha, mushrooms, and nootropics, and I'll admit, I am definitely not usually the kind of person to want to be an early adopter for ingredients like that, no matter whether they're natural. But Magic Mind only use ingredients with significant research backing up the claims. There are over 200 scientific studies behind each ingredient, which they have handily put together here if you are a naturally cautious person like I am. Here's something I'm curious about. Many of you have mentioned that I talk too fast in my videos. Well, after a week of Magic Mind and cutting down on my coffee, do you think that I've slowed down a bit? Let me know if I'm easier to follow. When Magic Mind reached out to me, they sent me a few shots to try and see if they worked for me first before sponsoring this video. If you're curious to try it too, head to magicmind.com/engwithrosie and use code Rosie20 to get up to 48% off your first subscription for the next 10 days or 20% off for a one-time purchase. Now let's refocus on battery recycling and take a look at the chemical engineering required to turn old batteries back into battery metals. The first thing that you need to do to an end-of-life battery that you'll want to recycle is to discharge it. This is usually done in a salt bath, but some companies are using more complicated setups so they can use whatever energy remains in the batteries. After discharging comes disassembling and shredding. In terms of mature technologies, there are two ways to recycle batteries or scrap from battery manufacturing, and those are pyrometallurgy and hydrometallurgy. Let's start with pyrometallurgy, where the pyro part means what you probably think it does, throwing it into a fire to melt the meltable stuff and burn the burnable stuff. The meltable materials are valuable metals like cobalt, copper, and nickel, and this is all that is recovered. The burnable stuff gets lost, and that includes the graphite, anode, organic electrolytes, battery separators, which are usually plastics, and lighter metals like lithium, aluminium, and manganese usually get lost too. Pyrometallurgy is a process that has been used for decades, so it's a mature technology that is also easily scalable to large volumes. For the metals that it can recover, it's very effective. However, the downsides are the amount of valuable materials that are lost during combustion and its high energy use. It can also have heavy environmental impact if harmful emissions and slag waste aren't effectively controlled. The other battery recycling method is hydrometallurgy, and the term hydro here refers to water-based solutions, acids or bases, being used to extract metals. It's a multi-step process. First is leaching. Acids such as sulfuric acid or bases such as sodium hydroxide are added to crushed battery materials, aka black mass, and metals are dissolved. Next, a sequence of techniques are used to separate and purify. The specific chemical properties of each metal of interest are exploited to separate them. One method to do this is solvent extraction, by adding a solvent that selectively binds to one type of metal atom. The solvent and the original solution don't mix, so the targeted metal atoms move into the solvent, leaving the others behind. The two liquids are then separated, allowing for efficient metal recovery. Another method is ion exchange, where metal ions in the solution are swapped with ions from a solid material called an ion exchange resin. The resin contains molecules that prefer to bond with specific metal ions, trapping the ones you want while releasing everything else. This allows selective removal of metals from the solution, after which the resin can be processed to recover the captured metals. Another method is pH adjustment, which involves altering a solution's acidity or alkalinity to make metal ions either precipitate or stay dissolved. By tweaking the pH, metals can be selectively separated since they react differently at various pH levels. Then, after the series of separations, the purified metals are recovered from the solution, often through precipitation or electrochemical processes, to form solid metal compounds that can be reused in new products. Hydrometallurgy can recover nearly all of the valuable metals like cobalt and nickel, and it can also recover lithium and other metals that would be lost in pyrometallurgical processes. It is more energy efficient than pyrometallurgy as it operates at much lower temperatures. However, the chemicals that are used have upstream emissions, so it's not guaranteed that it's a lower emissions process than pyrometallurgy. Due to these benefits, hydrometallurgy is widely used by top battery recycling companies, with many achieving over 95% recovery rates for essential metals like cobalt, manganese, nickel, and lithium. While this is progress, the challenge is in the details. Hydrometallurgy is more complex than pyrometallurgy. The reactions take longer, need more intricate equipment, and are costlier. It's also not as scalable for large battery volumes and can produce significant chemical waste, needing careful disposal to prevent environmental harm. As a result, despite recovering more valuable materials, hydrometallurgy tends to be more expensive overall. There is also a third option emerging, which doesn't just throw small bits of battery into a fire or a vat of acid. Direct recycling is a method of recovering battery materials by preserving the structure and chemistry of key components, particularly the cathode, rather than breaking them down into individual metals. Batteries are disassembled or cut up, and then mixtures of electrode materials are physically separated using techniques based on properties such as hydrophobicity, density, and magneticity. However, this technology is not yet as advanced as the other two. The main technical hurdles in direct recycling include preserving the performance of the recovered cathode materials, dealing with a diverse range of battery chemistries and battery formats, and particularly determining how to scale up effectively. Now that we've learned about recycling batteries, let's discuss how to ensure we actually do it. At the start of the video, I asked if you've ever seen someone dump their old car in a landfill and walk away. I assume you haven't. But why is that? There are two main reasons. Firstly, the parts or materials in an old car have significant value. And secondly, it's illegal to dispose of a car in a landfill. The combination of financial value and legal restrictions influences what gets recycled and what doesn't. So let's let's examine the economics and government policies surrounding battery recycling. There are dozens of battery recycling startups today, in addition to hundreds of established companies developing their recycling methods. Presumably, they all believe that battery recycling will be profitable, but are they right? Let's revisit the early examples of copper and aluminium as examples of successful recycling. Their recycled forms are worth more than the recycling costs. The materials hold significant value, and the process is comparatively inexpensive, making recycling overall profitable. In batteries, this equation looks quite different. Processing is not as cheap, especially not for hydrometallurgy, and the value of the metals is a big unknown. Only a couple of years ago, battery metal prices were high and rising, and everyone was obsessed with talking about how battery mineral shortages were a risk to the entire energy transition. Recycling looked very promising then, but since then, battery metal prices have fallen. That's been beneficial for the cost of batteries, but not so favorable for battery recycling economics. In a ton of black mass, there is about $4,600 worth of cobalt and $1,100 worth of nickel in today's prices. The other materials in there are worth far less, even the lithium that we were so paranoid about 2 years ago. According to Steve Cotton, who is CEO of battery recycling company Aqua Metals, at today's prices, the value of metals they can recover is sufficient to cover recycling costs. But a couple of years ago, things were even better. A ton of cobalt cost more than double what it does today. It's a similar story for nickel, and lithium was 6 times higher. And of course, no one knows if these prices will continue to drop. It's a bit of a risky business to be in when you don't know what your product is worth within a factor of 2 or more. Now, there's a related economic issue that we need to consider. Everyone wants cheap batteries, and in order to get them, alternative battery chemistries are being developed. Until a couple of years ago, it was all about NMC chemistry batteries. Nickel, manganese, cobalt, and those are all quite expensive metals. But now we're seeing a lot cheaper LFP batteries, lithium iron phosphate. They don't have cobalt or nickel or manganese, which eliminates most of the value that we had in the NMC black mass. The recycling process is not equivalently cheaper though. But on the other hand, there are other battery technology advances that should make recycling easier. For example, the graphite anodes in lithium iron batteries are hard to recycle and relatively low value. But in solid state batteries, these are replaced with lithium metal anodes, which are easier to recycle and more valuable. So it's pretty hard to say where exactly we'll end up. Now today, even if the value and cost of recycling is roughly in balance, companies are still struggling to survive because current recycling needs are small. The production of batteries for EVs and stationary storage has only ramped up in recent years, and it will be decades before most of these early lithium-ion batteries reach their end of life. Today, battery recycling feedstocks mostly come from manufacturing scrap and scooters rather than EVs that have reached the end of their life. And today, there is more recycling capacity than there is batteries to recycle, so facilities are running below capacity. There will be vastly more batteries to be recycled as the first wave of EVs reaches their end of life in coming years, which should make recyclers more profitable as recycling facilities can be more fully utilized and also scale up and run specialized lines for different products. So today, the economics are not all that great. And depending on what plays out in terms of future battery chemistries, metals prices, and recycling technologies, it may not be great into the future either, which doesn't make a very appealing business case, to be honest. But governments are stepping in with policies to support. A functioning recycling industry obviously means less mining for battery minerals, and for countries without resources to mine, it means less imports of critical minerals. Estimates suggest that it could reduce virgin material demand by nearly 30%. The security benefits of recycling are therefore very appealing and have attracted government support. The USA's Inflation Reduction Act promotes locally made EVs, batteries, and supply chains. Recycled EV battery materials count as American made for the subsidies, regardless of their origin. Over in Europe, there are new battery regulations coming in 2026. These include the introduction of battery passports to help track them and a recycling requirement at the end of a battery's life. Those are interesting developments to keep an eye on, but China is significantly ahead in both battery manufacturing and recycling capacities and can give us a sneak peek about how this industry could look at scale. And it is an example of how regulation can sometimes struggle to keep up with unexpected economic incentives. China has already enacted legislation on battery disposal. As part of this, China has around 160 whitelisted battery recycling companies who meet standards in environment, health, and safety. However, only a quarter of end-of-life batteries go through these official channels, and the remainder are being processed in black market recyclers, who lower costs by not having protection for workers or the environment. From this, we can understand that even if batteries have enough valuable, recoverable materials to finance their processing, which they currently do, successful recycling outcomes still require stringent oversight. Several efforts are underway to prevent batteries batteries from ending up in the black market or landfills. China has introduced a battery tracking platform with unique serial numbers for each battery, similar to future EU plans. NIO, an EV manufacturer, is starting a battery lease program where consumers rent batteries, keeping ownership with a third party to avoid black market sales. Other proposed solutions include deposit return schemes or subsidies to encourage proper battery disposal through approved channels. So to wrap things up, while the chemical engineering behind battery recycling is definitely very interesting, it's really the economics that I'm most keen to follow. It'll be interesting to see where this industry heads in the next few years and just how much government push and pull will be needed to keep things on track. Thanks to Magic Mind for sponsoring this video, and thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team for their ongoing support. You can join us at this link. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.